And I'll ask the city clerk to start us off with a roll call.
Yes, Councilmember Bertrand.
I'm here.
Councilmember Brooks.
Well, she's not. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Councilmember Brown.
Present.
Vice Mayor Kaiser.
Here.
Mayor Story.
Here. And then at this time, I'll ask the city clerk to proceed our meeting with an announcement.
Thank you, Mayor. In accordance with California Senate Bill 361, this meeting is not physically open to the public. Council and staff are meeting via Zoom, and there are several ways for the public to watch and participate. Information on how to join the meeting using Zoom or a landline or mobile phone, along with how to submit public comment during the meeting tonight, is available on our website, cityofcapitola.org, and on the published meeting agenda. The public can also live stream the meeting on the city's website. We're also streaming it on YouTube. As always, the meeting is cablecast live on Charter Communications Cable TV Channel 8 and is being recorded to be rebroadcast on the following Wednesday at 8 a.m. and on Saturday following the first rebroadcast at 1 p.m. on Charter Channel 71 and Comcast Channel 25. And our technician this evening is Olivia. Thank you, Olivia. Thank you, Mayor Story.
Yeah. Thank you, Chloe, for that. And also thank you, Olivia, for being our technician this evening. And next, we have Pledge of Allegiance. And I'm going to ask Vice Mayor Kaiser if she'll lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Sure. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the
United States of America,
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Vice Mayor Kaiser. Next, we have additions and deletions to the agenda. Does staff have any additions or deletions?
Staff has no changes to the agenda tonight.
In that case, we'll move on to a report on closed session from our city attorney.
Good evening, Mayor and council members. Closed session was had on the item on the agenda, and there is no reportable action. Thank you.
Thank you. And do we have any additional materials for this evening?
None were received.
Okay, well, moving right along, brings us to oral communication. This is an opportunity for members of the public to address the council on items that are not on tonight's agenda or for items that are on tonight's consent agenda. If you'd like to address the council, just raise your hand in Zoom, or you can dial *9. Our moderator will allow you to speak. And you'll have up to 3 minutes to speak. You may also send an email to publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us, and your email will be read for up to 3 minutes. Larry, looks like I see one hand up for a public comment.
Mayor Story, we have someone with the phone 1310.
310. Okay. Will you start the clock and allow that person to speak?
Yes, they're unmuted.
Hi, guys. I hope everyone's doing well this evening. Can you all hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Excellent. So I just have the one question. I'm sure you all know next week is Police Week, and I'm wondering if you would go over how the council is honoring our local officers.
You know, public comment is an opportunity for members of the public to address the council. It is not a dialogue between members of the public and council meetings in terms of the question and answer session. So if you would, you know, like to make a statement or a statement of appreciation for National Police Week, please to go ahead and do so. But the council members will not be answering questions off of public comment.
Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate your response, and have a great evening, guys.
All right. Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak during public comment?
Story, I do not see any hands raised. However, we do have an email that I can share my screen and have read, if that's okay.
Okay, thank you.
I'm just sure I remember how to do this. Here's the email. I will, oh, they changed things. Sorry, they changed the, there it is.
Dear Council Member in Capitola, I have been reporting to the authorities lately the gang signs and taggings which are visible though illegal action by some idiots. Hopefully, something can be done against this nonsense because according to my knowledge this illegal actions account to public destruction of City Capitola property. Thank you very much for your attention. Sincerely, Oren Kulpik, U.S. citizen. Army veteran.
Well, I just want to thank that person for their email.
We do not have any other emails for public comment, and I do not see any attendees with their hands raised.
Okay. Seeing no other public comment, I'm going to close the public comment portion of our meeting and take us to item six, which is staff and city council comments. Let's begin with staff comments.
I have one comment for you, and it's just one minor correction to item 7C on this evening's consent calendar. That's the travel policy. There's a minor typo in it that the maximum rate that's reimbursable for tips in one place says 15%, another place says 18%. The proposed ceiling is in fact 18% as a maximum reimbursable tip amount. So I just wanted to make that quote, make that correction noted. And in addition, I think we have one other staff comment. Chief Daly, thank you.
Thank you, City Manager. And Mayor Story Council, I just wanted to update everyone that this coming Saturday, we're going to have the second annual Skatecola. So it took a little hiatus through the pandemic, but we're happy to bring it back. So it'll be this Saturday from 11 to 4 at the McGregor Skate Park. We've partnered with our rec department, so we'll have a shuttle between the park and Shore Life Church. And then we're going to have Togo's, Left Coast Sausage, and Boardroom, and TC from Santa Cruz Boardroom and the Santa Cruz Apparel to be out there kind of DJing the contest. It'll be a really good event, youth outreach. We're going to have a pop-up event with the people that we're networking with the village. So like I said, if you're welcome to come out, it'll be this Saturday. It should be a lot of fun. And like I said, this Saturday, 11 to 4 at the McGregor Skate Park. So thank you.
Right. Thank you, Chief Alex. That's not like a lot of fun. Any other staff comments? Seeing none, I'll ask, are there council comments? Yeah, Council Member Brown.
Thank you, Mayor Story. I have a couple brief comments this evening. First, I would like to take a moment to acknowledge the hard work of our police and law enforcement in the city and throughout the county and the state and truly throughout the nation. I'm probably sounding like a broken record in noting that I come from a law enforcement family and that my grandfather worked for Capitola PD for many decades, so it's personal to me to take a moment to acknowledge all the hard work and to thank you for your service. I also believe that if it was last week or this week was also Public Works Week, to our Public Works staff, thank you as well for all of your work to keep our city as fantastic as it is. Again, the just from our police to our public works to really all the staff in our city is just absolutely phenomenal, and I feel very lucky to work with you and to have be in the city that you're all taking care of in this way. And then also I wanted to share, as I mentioned at our last regular meeting, May is Community Action Month. And as some of you may know, for the past 7 years, I've been CAB's public sector representative for the city of Capitola on their board of directors. CAB, of course, is the Community Action Board of Santa Cruz County and has been the county's designated community action agency tasked with eliminating poverty and creating social change through advocacy and essential services since 1965. We're also part of a national network of over 1,000 community action agencies across the country who are celebrating community action this month. And it's a time for us to reflect on our mission, our partnership, our values of equity and inclusion, and the difference that we make in the community. And so I just wanted to share in 2021, that difference for the Community Action Board of Santa Cruz County included serving over 10,000 low-income people, including with rent assistance for nearly 2,000 people to avoid evictions, food assistance for over 1,000, job readiness support and placement assistance for over 500 youth and adults, COVID information for over 1,300 people, including indigenous language speakers, and impacting over 7,800 immigrants and their families with immigration, legal, education, and advocacy services. And so to celebrate and raise awareness of Community Action Month, CAB is co-sponsoring events highlighting housing issues, immigrant voices and experiences, and climate resilience through the month of May. And CAB will be posting highlights of its work on social media on Impact Wednesdays, weekly in May. And for more information about this, you can follow CAB on social media or on their website at cabinc.org. And I just also want to share that it's truly been an honor to work with CAB for the past 7 years. It's really one of the organizations that I've worked with where you see their impact every time you come to the board meeting, every time you tell someone you're with CAB or organizing, or excuse me, affiliated with CAB. There's always a great story about what fantastic work they do. So I just wanted to, again, share that information about Community Action Month. Thank you.
Thank you, Council Member Brown. Any other council members have comments? Seeing none, I have a few comments. And first, I'd like to start by joining Council Member Brown in acknowledging that next week, actually May 15th to the 21st, is National Public Works Week. And that is an opportunity and a time to thank our public works director and our public works staff for all the hard work they do to keep the city clean and safe. So thank you, and I would encourage members of the public, if you see your public works crew out there, give them a high five and a thank you for everything they do for us. Thank you, Steve. And I also want to join Council Member Brown in acknowledging that next week, and actually May 15th, is National Police Week. It runs from May 15th through the 21st. And that is also an opportunity for us to show our support for the fine officers that we have in our community. And this is particularly a time of remembrance for officers who have lost their lives in the line of duty. They make the greatest sacrifices for us. So I would encourage members of the public to remember that next week is National Police Week. And if you see a Capitola police officer or a San Luis County sheriff, to give them a high five, thank them for what they do, and that we really do appreciate your service. I also wanted to report out on the Arts Commission meeting that was last Tuesday. There were a lot of arts projects that are in line to be completed. The first is The Arts Commission approved the call to artists, and that's where artists are going to be solicited to make proposals concerning the stump that is in the lower Monterey, or the lower Village and Beach parking lot. So we'll be seeing some activity there on that stump. We also, the Arts Commission approved the call to artists for artists to do a project on the railing along the Monterey Avenue going from the village up toward Park Avenue. It's on the right side of the railing on, next to the sidewalk, and there's proposed projects to put an art installation at that location. The Arts Commission, in assistance with city staff, have also finalized the upcoming Twilight concerts, and just wanted to let everybody know that those are going to be starting on June the 15th, and they will run until August 31st. Every Wednesday, starting at 6 p.m., there'll be a series of 12 concerts, and you can go to our website to get more information about the particular bands that will be playing. At the end of August, there will also be two free outdoor movies. So that's my report on Arts Commission activity. And then looks like Councilmember Brown, did you have your hand up once again?
Yes, yeah, thank you, Mayor. Sorry. My apologies. There was something I forgot to add previously.
No worries.
And it's kind of related to the upcoming police week. So I'm a member of the Criminal Justice Council of Santa Cruz County, and we had our meeting today, and I just wanted to report out. Last year, the Capitola Police Department was part of a report that the Criminal Justice Council compiled on Santa Cruz County Regional Public Safety Agency policy review and analysis. And it looks through the policies of Capitola PD, Santa Cruz PD, Watsonville, Sheriff, you know, the whole county. And we believed at the time that we were one of the first in the state to do a report like that. And the chair of the CJC, Supervisor Friend, let us know today that that report was submitted to the National Association of Counties for a nationwide award. And we received it. We received the nationwide award for this report. And they don't believe that there's actually any other agency in the country that have done this kind of work in looking at regional public safety agency policies. So I just wanted to, again, thank you to our Capitola Police Department, for the other law enforcement agencies, for Supervisor Friend, who chairs the CJC, as well as Santa Cruz County Council member Justin Cummings, who was a part of creating the survey, everyone who was involved. It's a really exciting thing to see our regional agencies come together to do something like this and receive national recognition for it. Thank you for the additional time. I appreciate it.
Well, yes. Well, thank you for coming back and sharing that. That sounds like a very awesome award to receive, and congratulations. Thank you for your work on the CJC and for all the other members and to achieve this accomplishment. So any other comments this evening from council members? Seeing none, I'm going to move us on to the consent items. These items will be taken with one vote, unless there's a council member that would like to pull an item for further discussion. Does the council member wish to pull one of the consent items? Seeing none, is there a motion to approve?
I move approval of the consent.
There's a motion by Councilmember Brown. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Yes, yeah, seconded by Councilmember Bertrand. Can we have a roll call vote, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I approve.
Councilmember Brown.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Kaiser. I think I saw Vice Mayor Kaiser. I'm sorry. I didn't hear anything.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. you. And Mayor Story?
Aye.
Thank you.
The motion passes unanimously of the council members who are present this evening. And so that will bring us to item 8 this evening, which is our general government public hearing. The first public hearing is an application from the Capitola Village and Wharf Business Improvements Association to replace the arbor sign at Stockton Avenue and Capitola Avenue. The recommended action is to consider an application from the Capitola Village and Wharf Improvement Association to replace the sign hanging at Stockton Capitola Avenue Arbor with a surfboard style design. Can we have a staff report, please?
Absolutely. Good evening, Mayor and Council. First, I'd like to thank all the support mentioned tonight from the Public Works Department. Crew worked hard and the offices worked equally hard. So I appreciate the support the Council has given us, not only today, but over the years that we've had the department together. So I appreciate it. Moving forward, the item for you tonight, let me share my screen. Always an adventure. Larry, are we good?
Looks good.
Thank you. So the item tonight, as you mentioned in the agenda, was considering an application from the BIA to replace the existing sign in the arbor, which is a parking directional sign, with a sign based on a surfboard. So a little quick background here. The city approved an administrative policy for regarding decorations in the village, and we're counting this as a decoration. It does fall under the guidance of this policy to hang signs and banners. The BIA applied in last year at this time to replace the existing sign under the arbor with new signs comprised of two surfboards. The council at that time continued the hearing and requested the BIA to return better mock-ups of the proposed design. Those proposals where they were going to use actual surfboards, I actually have a picture of it, but it was hard to tell exactly how it was going to look. The current proposal, the BIA submitted a new proposal. It's continuing with the surfboard design. They consulted a local design shop, and the design graphic provided better represents the actual color response and layout that will be done. So just to make sure we're all in the same place here, this is the corner of Stockton Avenue and Capitola Avenue. This is the arbor, and this is the sign that we're existing sign that's there today. Get close enough so you can read it. It is welcome to Capitola Village with all day parking in this picture. So this sign was put in as part of the Arts Commission project to re-sign directional signs to the parking lots behind City Hall. There were signs that started here and then continued along both Capitola Avenue and led people to the parking lot. There was a similar sign like this too on the back of the police department. And then there are signs that are still existing today up in the parking lot that point to how pedestrians are supposed to get to the village. So there's a design. Many of the signs, the directional signs, have been replaced by a yet subsequent version of how to get people into the parking lot behind City Hall. So the sign behind the police department has been replaced with a blue and white sign that has the more universally accepted white P for parking. Many people felt that this wasn't as clear on this sign or the designs here. So many of the directional signs are gone. This is about the only one remaining, except for the ones in the parking lot themselves, which direct pedestrians back to the village. Those were actually reprinted and reformatted, I think, a year and a half ago and replaced. So those still exist. So this was the proposal last year, very fundamental design, hard to tell exactly how they were going to look, what colors the surfboards were going to be, and everything. So this was the submission that the council continued. This is the submission that's in front of you today. You can see it has a wood grain, differing colors. It continues with the blue lettering and the white P on a blue background, which is kind of universally identified with a parking symbol. Looking a little closer, the proposed sign will be 96 inches wide by 28 inches high. To give you an idea, the existing sign is 90 inches wide and 34 inches high. So this will be a little longer, 6 inches longer, and 6 inches narrower. The narrowness will actually allow probably lower it down a little bit further, so it may be more visible. This design by Pleasure Point Design is a digital print laminated on aluminum. That's how our street signs that the city has made are done. When we do the connections to the arbor, it'll be designed so it doesn't swing. And this was recommended and supported by the board of directors of the BIA. I'll mention now that I believe two members of the BIA are present in tonight's meeting and available to discuss and answer any questions the council may have about the sign. So the recommended action is to consider this application from the Capitola Village Orphan Business Association to replace the sign hanging at the Stockton Capitola Avenue Arbor with a surfboard style design. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
The questions from council members on the staff report? Seeing none, Steve, I had a quick question. Assuming that this replacement sign is approved, do we use the old sign? That one would be removed, and that's part of the proposal.
The old sign will be removed.
Will it?
Yes, it will.
Right. And is there any place that it could be used? We could use it?
We could look at, it might be a little confusing to have both signs in the back of the police department. We could certainly look at it and try and find another area for it. I think the goal right now is to try and get a uniform design back again with the white P and the blue background, but we could look and try and find an area for it.
Okay. Because we have the sign similar to that up in the upper parking lot still. And so it seems like it could maybe fit in. Of course, I know the arrow could make it problematic, but hopefully, it's something that could be reused instead of just being discarded. Any other questions on the staff report? Vice Mayor Tysis.
Thanks. I was just going to piggyback on your comment, Sam. Maybe somewhere at the top of, it might be RTC territory, but at the top of Monterey, near Park Avenue, because then that way the arrow could point down in towards the parking lot. And sometimes people who can't find parking in the village, they may not know. And so they're exiting the village and then they might see that. That could work. I'm not sure. But repurposing that would be awesome.
Got it. We'll look, do what we can.
Yeah, that's a good recommendation, Vice Mayor Tysis. Any other questions? Seeing none, I'm going to take this out and see if members of the public would like to address the council on this item. If so, please raise your hand in Zoom, or you can dial *9. The moderator will allow you to speak for up to 3 minutes. Or if you prefer, you can send an email to publiccomments@ci.capitola.ca.us. I see one hand up. Larry, if you could.
Anthony.
Hi, Council. Thank you for letting us see you on the agenda tonight. The biggest thing for us is we want to get the guests out of their car into the parking lot as soon as possible. As they come down Stockton, the Esplanade backs up, and it makes it hard for pedestrians walking. And just the general direction of putting the guests in the parking lot as quick as possible. For us, it's a brightening the sign up so they can see it. We've already worked with Steve. He's already trimmed back the arbor so that the shade of that doesn't cover the current sign. So with the brighter sign, trimming of the arbor, I think it'll enhance the viewpoint from the customers in their car and get them to the parking lot as quick as possible. So I'd hope you guys would consider, you know, updating the sign and putting this one up so as summer's right around the corner. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Anthony. Since we have a second hand on this item, Larry.
Yep. Karen Hannah.
Go ahead, Karen.
I think this greatly livens up that little corner. It's a much more contemporary look for the village, which I think is way more appropriate than the 1880s version of the signage. And it's fresh, clean, and I think that it's going to be a big improvement because it'll be easy to read. So I hope you'll consider it.
Thank you.
We have Vicki.
Hello.
Hi, Vicki. Go ahead.
I'd like to say that I sit at the David Ling office across from this location for this sign that we're trying to get approved. And I look at the existing sign every day, and it's rather faded and looks a little sad to me. And I think it would be really nice to have this kind of updated and current and fun surfboard sign and the international symbol for the parking blue, I think fits very well. So I hope you consider it.
Thank you, Vicki.
Mayor Suri, I do not see any other attendees with their hands raised, and we do not have any emails on this item.
Okay, seeing no other members of the public wanting to address the council, I'm going to close public comment at this time and bring it back to council for further deliberation and possible action. Is there a council member that would like to lead us on this? Yeah, Councilmember Brown.
Thank you, Mayor Story. I know that when the BIA came to us with the original sign proposal back in 2021, we had a lot of questions, we had a lot of feedback, we had a lot of requests for them to bring us additional information. And so I just want to take a moment to acknowledge the time that they've put into this. As the council's representative to the BIA, I've been on the meetings when they had the vote on this design. They discussed the process that went into creating it, the color schemes, the font, all of that good stuff that back in 21 we had asked them to do. And so I think that this is going to be a good addition to that corner, especially because it focuses specifically on pointing people towards parking, which we know we need to get them to. So again, just appreciation to Karen and Anthony for their leadership at the BIA and everyone who took part in this. And I'd like to move approval of the sign.
There's a motion for approval. Is there a second?
Yeah, I'll second that. Thank you.
Okay, second by Vice Mayor Kaiser. Are there further comments by the council members? Seeing none, Chloe, I'll ask for a roll call vote.
Councilmember Bertrand.
Councilmember Bertrand. You're on mute.
My normal way of the space bar didn't work, so I approve.
Thank you. Councilmember Brown.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Kaiser.
Aye.
Mayor Story.
Aye.
Thank you.
And that motion passes unanimously to approve the BIA's new sign. We look forward to seeing it go up. And thank you as well, everyone, for their work to, beautify Capitola. So with that, well, let's move on to the next item on our agenda for this evening, which is the Women on Waves surf and swim contest. The recommended action is to consider expanding women on wave surf and swimming contest, a previously approved general special event, from a one-day to a two-day event. Chief Daly, you're going to lead us on this?
Yes.
All right. Thank you.
Perfect. Good evening, Mayor and Council. And let me begin by sharing my screen. Larry, how's it looking?
Andy, you're sharing, you have your note slide. That's what you're showing.
Bill, just sharing the notes?
Yeah, I mean, we can see it.
Okay. If it's still a note.
Yeah, but I can zoom in on the one slide.
Okay, if you can do that. All right, well, good evening, Council, Mayor and Council. Tonight, I'm going to be presenting on the Women on Waves Surf and Swim Contest. We'll be touching on what exactly is the Women on Waves. I'll provide a little bit of the background and how we got to this evening, and then we'll touch on what their request is this evening. Can you go next slide there, Larry? I can do it. Okay, so Women on Waves is a women and girls surfing and surfing and swim contest, and it's there to highlight and celebrate women surfing while raising money for nonprofits. It's Alana Vanfield is the one that's been the leader of this organization, which is Ola Chica is her brand. And like I said, they do surf and swim contests. They also have vendors throughout the day that sell event apparel, sunscreen, jewelry, and arts and crafts. They have booths along the Esplanade, the grassy area there, and at the Esplanade Park. They also provide a skin cancer screening tent. And the impacts are limited to the Esplanade Park and Capitola Beach. We do not require any road closures, and the event is primarily focused just on the Esplanade, the surfing, and the surf and the beach. Providing a little bit of background. So this has been a very successful event for Capitola. It's actually one of the few ones that's kind of started as a minor permit. So they, back in 2018, they had a minor event permit, which typically is those that are under 200 people and have a little to low impact from the city. And so they had that permit for 2018, and it was actually a very, very successful event that year. And so at that time, because of the size of the event, it was actually a really sunny day with lots of swell. And so we requested that they come back to the council to talk about upgrading that permit from a minor to a general. And so that was done in 2019. Council granted the general permit. And then unfortunately, the pandemic hit shortly thereafter. And so for 2020, it became a virtual event. And then this last year, 2021, it was, again, a very successful event. And so they returned back to council to see if they can extend it from a one-day to a two-day event. And because it's a significant change to the permit, it has to come back to council. And so understanding that just a brief summary on our special event permits, the general is anyone those events are 200 or more that have significant impacts to the city services, and then minor events are those that are less than 200. And so with that, the Women on Waves, and we have Alana here at the police department that's available to take any questions. But their request at this point is to expand their current permit from a one-day event to a two-day event. And so the recommended action at this point is to consider expanding the Women on Waves swimming and surf contests from a previously approved general event from a one-day to a two-day event. And that event takes place on October, typically in the month of October, and the request is it would take place on October 22nd and 23rd of this coming year. And with that, I can stop sharing, and I'm open for any questions, and I see Alana is here in Captain Ryan's office.
Yeah. Thanks, Chief Gallant, for briefing us on the request. I'll ask if council members have questions for Chief Gallant. Yes, Vice Mayor Kaiser.
Thanks, Mayor. So I guess my question for, so having a second day, is it basically 2 days worth of a contest and having all sort of the same events each day, or is it going to be broken up into two different things?
It's my understanding it would be broken up into two-day events, so it'd be a contest on both days.
Okay.
Essentially, they're just spreading the event out from a one-day event into a two-day event.
Great, thank you.
Any other questions from council members? Seeing none, I had a couple of questions, Chief Valley. One, I noticed in the application that it mentions that they're going to be bringing or placing a porta potty at the Esplanade. I was just wondering, since we have public restrooms there, whether that will be required or is necessary, then maybe it would save them a little money on expenses.
Sure. The reason that we requested the portable toilet is because with a general event, depending on the numbers and the impact, that we add that extra toilet. And so the projected numbers, I think we're looking at 250 to 350 people. And so that's where we required that extra restroom.
I see. Okay. I'll defer to your judgment on that then. My other question goes to, I also noticed, the early start time, 7:30 a.m., and that they're going to be having amplified music. And I just want to maybe request that that the amplified music not start at 7:30 a.m. on a Saturday and Sunday morning. And if you give the residents that live there, maybe a little, quiet in their morning until maybe a little bit later before you get into full swing. So just wanted to maybe, make that, request of the event provider. Assuming that their application is approved.
Yeah. Absolutely, we can put conditions on the noise, and we do so. We take into consideration the time, especially the morning start times. So absolutely.
Good. Yeah. Thank you. With there being no further questions, I'm going to just check and see if there's any members of the public that would like to address the council on this permit request application.
Mayor Story, I do not see any attendees or people on phones with their hands raised, and we have not received any public comment emails on this item.
Okay. Reaffirm that if anybody wants to send an email, they can send it to public comment at ci.capitola.ca.us.
We do not have any other emails.
Okay, looks like nothing's coming in, so I'm going to close the public comment portion of on this item, and I'll bring it back to council for further discussion and potential action. Council Member Brown.
Thank you. I'm excited to see that this could become a two-day event. I think it's always important to essentially work on granting access to these kind of ocean sports to women and to people of color. And I know that we've got other organizations in the community that do the same. And so I'm really excited to see that this could become a two-day event. So I'd like to go ahead and move approval for the general special event permit for a two-day event. Would that be the correct language for that motion?
I think that would serve the purpose, yes.
All right.
And is there a second?
I'll second. I have a comment, too.
Okay, well, that's a second by Councilmember Bertrand. And go ahead, Councilmember Bertrand.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mayor. I saw this contest very early on when it was almost a labor of love. Someone took it on that I think, because she was so motivated. And I, too, agree with Kristen. It's wonderful that it's gone to 2 days. Every time I go down there, it's well run. And, you know, Chief, if you decide that they need more help or whatever, they definitely will cooperate with you as you see fit. That's my impression with the group. And, you know, I have the sense that they've gotten, you know, I can't say more professional because I don't know what a professional group is like this, but, you know, it's a well-run machine and they seem to do a great job. So I'm totally in support of it, and that's why I second them.
And thank you, Councilmember Bertrand. Seeing no other comments by council members, I'm going to ask the clerk to take a roll call vote.
Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Brown.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Kaiser.
Aye.
Mayor Story.
Aye. And the motion passes unanimously of those council members who are present this evening. And so congratulations. You're on for a second day. We really enjoy having you here and look forward to a full weekend of surfing and waves, and now we just need the waves to cooperate so you can have an exciting competition. So thank you for bringing this to us, and we look forward to seeing you on it's October 23rd and 24th. Just to, did I get that right? I want to
22nd and 23rd.
Okay, October 22nd and 23rd is when the event will take place. So, thank you. I'm going to now move us on to the next item, which is Senate Bill 9, Residential Development and Urban Lot Split Ordinance. So this is not as fun as the previous item, but. So let's see. Well, let's get through it. And the recommended action, and I'm going to read it so members of the public know, you know, what we're shooting for. But it's one to introduce by title only and waiving further reading of the text, an ordinance of the City of Capitola adding municipal code chapters 16.78 and 17.75. And adding municipal code section 16.08.020, amending section 17.74040 for the implementation of government code sections 66411.7 and 65852.21 related to urban lot split and Senate Bill 9 residential development. And then the second item is to adopt proposed resolution authorizing submittal to the California Coastal Commission for the certification of amendments to the local coastal program, adding the municipal code sections, and I'm not going to repeat them, but the same ones that I just stated, the amendments and relating to, yeah, those are, that's a repetition what I just said. So I think we're ready to proceed with the staff report.
Okay, thank you, Mayor Story and Council. We'll try to make this fun, but not sure we'll try our best.
I'm sure you can do it, yes.
So This evening, we have Ben Noble of Ben Noble City and Regional Planning, and I think he's a familiar face to you all at this point. Ben's responsible for helping update the general plan for Capitola and then our zoning ordinance. He's been doing work for the city for, I think, over a decade and a half at this point. So with that, I'm going to hand this presentation over to Ben, who's been instrumental in updating in this SB9 ordinance.
Katie?
Yes.
Pull up the presentation.
You know what? I'm seeing the agenda packet, not the
presentation.
Yeah. There we go.
There we go. Okay. Well, thank you, Katie. Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. Again, my name is Ben Noble. I'm the consultant that has been working with Katie on the SB9 implementing ordinances. And this item was presented to the council at the previous meeting, so we're going to give a relatively streamlined presentation tonight since you have already had the previous opportunity to become familiar with the material. So as the mayor summarized, this is a set of implementing ordinances for Senate Bill 9, SB9, which is recently adopted state law relating to multi-unit development within single-family zones. And so there are two main components to this draft ordinance before the council tonight. The first component is amendments to the zoning code, which is Title 17 within your municipal code. And that consists of a new chapter 1775, entitled SB9 Residential Development, and then another small amendment to the zoning code related to accessory dwelling units and how the ADU rules relate to SB9 projects. And the second main component of the SB9 implementing ordinances is a new chapter within the subdivision ordinance, which is Title 16 of the Municipal Code. So a new chapter 1678, urban lot split, as well as one other small amendment to the subdivision ordinance, adding a definition for urban lot. So to review SB9 was adopted last year and went into effect on January 1st of 2022. It was adopted by the legislature of the state and signed into law by the governor. And what it does is it requires all cities and counties throughout the state of California to allow a lot split within a single family zone. It calls this an urban lot split. And then on each of those new lots, SB9 allows up to two units. And so if you have an existing parcel within a single family zone that's at least 2,400 square feet, under SB9, an applicant can request ministerial over-the-counter approval of up to four units. SB9 does allow cities to limit the size of those units to 800 square feet. What this means for cities throughout California is that within single-family zones, such as the R1 zone in Capitola, cities must allow up to four 800-square-foot units on a typical size R1 lot. So Capitola is not alone among cities and counties in the state in trying to figure out how best to implement the requirements of SB9 at the local level. Here's a zoning map that shows all of the areas that are zoned R1 within the city of Capitola. So those are the brighter yellow areas. This map also shows the boundary of the coastal zone, which is that purple dashed line. And SB9 applies in both the coastal zone and outside of the coastal zone, with some ability for the city to fine-tune some of the rules to address the requirements of the Coastal Act, which I'll talk about a little bit more. So this SB9 is broadly applicable to all R1 zoned areas in the city, including a diversity of neighborhood types such as Cliffwood Heights with relatively larger lots and the Jewel Box with smaller lots. One of the challenges to implement SB9 in Capitola is to figure out what rules will work in a diversity of characteristics within the different neighborhoods of Capitola. So within the SB9 ordinance, there are development standards for these SB9 projects. And one of the things that we found working with the Planning Commission is that on lots that are 5,500 square feet or more, we're able to accommodate up to four 800 square foot lots using development standards, which the Planning Commission generally supported and thought were reasonable. So on a lot that's 5,500 square feet or more in a neighborhood such as Cliffwood Heights, we can accommodate four 800 square foot units with a 15 foot front setback, two stories in height, and one on-site parking space per unit located behind the front buildings and accessed from one single shared driveway to preserve existing on-street parking. And these development standards were priorities to the Planning Commission, and a project, an SB9 project under this ordinance on a lot 5,500 square feet or more would be required to comply with these standards. So I think the Planning Commission, in their recommendations to the council, felt pretty good about these larger lots. It becomes more challenging on the smaller lots. The good news is that for a two-unit project on a smaller lot, a lot that's less than 5,500 square feet, we can still accommodate the Planning Commission's priorities of keeping the height to two stories, keeping a front 15-foot setback, and requiring parking to be located behind the front building with a shared driveway. And so this would be a two-unit project. And one of the things that we did in the ordinance is that we allowed more floor area for a two-unit project than for a three- or four-unit project because we wanted to encourage two-unit projects. Because the design that is achievable for a two-unit project is superior to what is possible for a three or four unit project. So for that reason, rather than limiting the unit size to 800 square feet for a two unit project, this ordinance would allow up to 1,200 square feet per unit. Now, on a small lot with four units, it becomes much more challenging. This is a smaller lot, and fitting four 800 square foot units on this lot while accommodating on-site parking becomes challenging. So the Planning Commission was faced with a situation where they had to give up on a lower priority standard. And the majority of the Planning Commission, but not all Planning Commissioners, supported standards that would allow for one parking space to be located behind the main building with one shared driveway accessing that parking. But to achieve that, we needed to increase the allowable height to three stories, and we needed to allow buildings to be located within the front setback. Otherwise, it's just not possible to accommodate four 800 square foot unit. So if under this ordinance, if an applicant were to propose an SB9 project with four units on a lot less than 5,500 square feet, these are the development standards that would apply to that project. And as I mentioned, it was not a unanimous recommendation on the development standards for these smaller lots from the Planning Commission. Three of the five Planning Commissioners supported what you see before you, option B, which is what's in the draft ordinance before you. The Planning Commissioners also looked at other options, including option A, which would keep the building height to two stories, would have the building set back from the front property line by 15 feet or more, but would require four on-site parking spaces to be located between the building and the street with one continuous curb cut along the street frontage to accommodate those parking spaces. So there were two planning commissioners who preferred option A, but the majority of the planning commissioners preferred option B, which is the standards that have been incorporated into the ordinance that's before you tonight. So that was the main topic of conversation among planning commissioners when they ultimately voted on their recommendation, and was the one item where there were differences of opinion among commissioners. So one other aspect in the SB9 ordinance is that there are some standards and provisions that relate specifically to protecting coastal resources consistent with the California Coastal Act, as well as the city's local coastal program. So there's language within the SB9 statute that says that SB9 does apply within the coastal zone, but that SB9 shall not supersede or in any other alter or lessen the effect of the California Coastal Act. So the way the Coastal Commission has been interpreting this is similar to how they interpret state ADU law, which has the same language, which essentially is that both cities with areas in the coastal zone should look for ways to harmonize their local SB9 ordinances with the requirements of the Coastal Act and their certified local coastal program. So given that, what this draft ordinance does is it prohibits SB9 projects within a number of specific areas that are identified in your local coastal program. So those are geological hazard areas immediately along the bluff, for example, the 100 and 500 year flood hazard areas in the area in the village and near the creek, as well as environmentally sensitive habitat areas. So within those limited geographic areas, SB9 projects would not be allowed. The one other thing related to the Coastal Act within this ordinance has to do with parking. So there are some specific geographic areas identified where one on-site parking space would always be required, that no exceptions are possible. And the reason that this is in there is because there's language within SB9 that says that if an SB9 project is within a certain distance from a car share vehicle, that no on-site parking is required. And because of the priority of preserving public coastal access within Capitola and challenges associated with parking and maintaining and preserving coastal access, we've included this provision within the draft ordinance that would always require at least one on-site parking space within these gray areas without the ability for there to be an exception due to proximity to a car share vehicle or transit facility. So one last thing in the presentation is in response to council comments on the draft that was presented on April 28th, we did make an amendment to the language that concerns eligibility for SB9 development, just to clarify that consistent with state law. And this is something that the city attorney has reviewed and signed off on as well. So we made that minor revision that is shown in underlined strike through within the packet ordinance. So in terms of environmental review, that this ordinance amendment is statutorily exempt from CEQA under the government code because it implements SB9. So with that, staff's recommendation is for the City Council to introduce and waive further reading of the zoning code amendments and the subdivision ordinance in order to implement SB9. And this recommendation from staff is consistent with the recommendation from the Planning Commission. And then also for the City Council to adopt a resolution authorizing staff to submit the zoning code amendments to the Coastal Commission for them to certify as part of the city's LCP amendment. So with that, that concludes my presentation, and Katie and I are happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Yeah, thank you, Ben. Council members have questions on the presentation. Council member Bertrand?
I do have a question. There's a section in 16.78.02 that deals with urban lot subdivisions. And I know what it is, but maybe, Ben, you're familiar with it, or Katie, you're familiar with it offhand. So it talks about you can't do a subdivisions next to a lot that's already been subdivided, according to this ordinance. Is that the intent there?
Yeah, so Katie, would you like me to?
I could point out what page it's on if that's what you want.
If you could just give me the number again, I can make sure I'm looking at it.
Yeah, it's in 16.78.02 under section 8B in the agenda. It's page 2 of 8.
Okay.
Hey, I also wanted to point out to everyone, Layla from my office is here. She worked with staff on drafting this ordinance.
Thank you, Sam. And Layla,
thank you guys.
So the section reads, neither the owner of the parcel being subdivided, which is what we're talking about, nor any person acting in concert with the owner has previously subdivided an adjacent parcel using the urban lot split as provided for in this chapter. So I'm just trying to understand the intent. I sort of think you don't want things subdivided right next to other lots that have been subdivided, but maybe that's not yet. So that's why I'm asking the question.
Councilmember, yeah. I can jump in and answer that as well. So the intent behind that was in order to ensure that the lot splits that are occurring are only for the purposes of the urban lot splits, which allows you to split one lot into two. What we don't want, and what state law is also trying to avoid, is folks doing a series of urban lot splits, which would then you would end up with basically a mini subdivision, which would normally fall under the other provisions of the Subdivision Map Act. So that's why there's that catch-all in there. Yes, you can do an urban lot split, but not if you're working with your neighbor to also do more urban lot splits, and then suddenly you have multiple parcels when the intent was just to have the one split.
Okay, I understand it. So if I did a split, I'm in Clifford Heights. If I did a split on my lot, and then a year later, the neighbor next to me on one side or the other want to do a split, that doesn't apply. It's just if I do it in concert with other property owners?
Correct.
Okay, so in a year from now, someone else could do it next to me. So this isn't meant to prevent a whole thing that's a string of splits. It's just the concert of doing it because you have another ordinance or another legal mechanism to deal with subdivisions.
Exactly.
Okay, thanks, Layla. I appreciate that.
Other council members have questions on the staff report? Seeing none, I had some questions. And one, I'd like to focus in on that split vote at the Planning Commission, that this whole conflict between height and off-street parking. And I was wondering if during that discussion there was a recognition or the sense that just because you try to accommodate garages, whether or not those garages would be used, seems like you would still potentially end up with a lot of on-street parking. I assume that that's what the Planning Commission was trying to avoid. But what is there anything in this ordinance to compel people to use off-street parking or use their garages?
So I think as we realized on the smaller lots, they would have to go to additional height. The buildings have to be designed with a garage because there's not enough available space to allow them to have an uncovered parking space because you're now forcing, there's just not enough open space in which to put uncovered parking. So that's really the reason why you're seeing in all of, in our examples, garages. And the other point about the split vote with the Planning Commission, the two commissioners that would have preferred to have the parking in the front, some of the comments that were made were the reason for that vote was to preserve the front yard setback. So even though the cars would be in the front yard and it's not a lawn or a beautiful green space, it preserves that setback of where the structures are typically built in the R1 zone. So that front facade is 15 feet back and kind of follows the pattern of the street. I remember Commissioner Ruth commenting on the fact that when you walk outside of the of one of the SB9 proposals, you'd be able to look, or you could, it would maintain that view down the street with homes still 15 feet back. And with the ordinance as proposed, and in some instances, the structures being all the way to the front, you'll lose that view corridor down the street. So, does that make?
No, thank you for that clarification. My next question goes to the exemption for requiring off-street parking. There were two. One is, if it's near a bus corridor or center, which that's understandable, you can discern that. But the other exemption is there's a rideshare vehicle nearby. Are there more heightened definitions of what may qualify as a rideshare vehicle and nearby, or?
Right, so that's language that's directly from state law, and it's similar to language.
I understand, and I'm just wondering if anybody's attempted to try to define that, or so it can be correctly interpreted and applied.
Yes, so there is a definition for. We will use for that.
Oh, and just to clarify, I mean, I said it does say within one block. I assume that does put some dimensions on it, but I'm still not sure what qualifies as a car shared vehicle.
So in terms of terms used in this provision, there's high quality transit corridor that's defined in the public resource code. And I think that's bus with headway 15 minutes before or less. Major transit stop, which is also defined in the public resources code. And I don't know that off the top of my head, but we could look at that. So those are defined terms. The car share vehicle, I don't know off the top of my head if there's a accepted definition that we would use for that. Maybe counsel, city attorney knows on that. If not, I would imagine that we could add a definition within the ordinance that would add clarity to that, if that's important.
Yeah, I can chime in. Definitely agree, Mayor Story, that it is not the clearest definition in state law. Like you said, it limits the car share vehicle within one block, but it doesn't really say how often the vehicle has to be there, or whether it can be a privately owned vehicle, or whether it has to be, you know, owned and operated by a company, etc. So we can definitely go back and add a definition that will help clarify that. I think that's wonderful.
Great, thank you for that. And my last question is assuming that we, well, I don't know that we really have any choice, but this will pass. But once it does, are we able to claim these additional potential units under our LEMA allocation to count toward that effort?
Yes, so we cannot.
I'm sorry to cut you off.
Okay. Yes, we can count. We can count future units towards our RENA calculation. It'll all be dependent on when they pull their building permit, whether or not it would count in the current cycle or in the next cycle. But yes, new units built through SB9 can be counted in our RENA. We'll get credit for it.
But, you know, under the RENA, we're required to just provide opportunity sites. And since these opportunity sites are going to be in all R1 zoning for all lots over 2,400 square feet, will those all count as opportunity sites?
So, that is a little more dicey. Currently, when we identify our sites for RENA, like ADUs would be another example of areas in which we have the allowance to have more development. Although they are counted and they count once built, they'll count. In terms of like identifying future sites, we would not look to our R1 neighborhoods and identify the additional potential within the R1. So.
Thank you.
Unfortunately.
That's less satisfying, but
yeah.
I thought maybe it was a good effort. So, thank you for responding to my question. I think we have a follow-up question from Councilmember Bertrand.
Thank you, Mayor. I do. A couple of questions. In terms of the driveway, there was a couple of comments about the width of driveways, 12 feet, I think, max. So is that fire approved by the fire department? And then in another case, there was a driveway that would sort of look like a tunnel. So should there be a stipulation of the height? Because some of these fire vehicles are kind of tall. Might make design very difficult for that building. So those are my questions, and I got two others.
So any development project that would come through would have to be reviewed by fire for compliance. And those, the examples we gave you, they're very trying to just figure out how we could fit the square footage on the lot, but they'll have to be fine-tuned in order to comply with fire regulations. We didn't go that far in our design.
Okay, does that come back to us, or I mean, staff does that, and that's basically how you work that out?
Yeah, SB9 applications will be reviewed administratively by staff, so they won't go in front of Planning Commission or City Council.
Thank you so much. And also, in terms of separation, there was a couple, there's some discussion about, the buildings right up against each other. Are they conjoined, like, same foundation, everything, or do they have to have like a quarter inch separate? I was just wondering what's going on there.
They can have a shared wall between the two
okay.
units.
Okay.
Planning Commission thought it was important to maintain the side yard setbacks on the like exterior periphery of the original R1 lot, but where they create a new lot line in between, the Planning Commission said as long as the impact is on them to have a zero lot line. So for that internal lot line, which was split, the buildings can be built right up to that property line, the new property line.
Yeah, well, that makes sense. They're sort of like twins. And there's a mention of accessory units, and I wasn't sure what that meant. I can't recall where it came up, but I think I read it early on. And so accessory units, not like an ADU that's an accessory house, but So if this throws people for a loop, I don't want to waste time on it, but if it comes to mind.
Yes, Councilmember Bertrand, the accessory unit would, I'm not sure exactly what portion of it you were reading, but there is an allowance for accessory dwelling units to be built in addition, or an accessory dwelling unit to be built in addition to a two-unit development. However, according to SB 9 and also included in the draft ordinance before you, there is an exception for if a property owner has partaken in the lot split as well as a two-unit development, they've done both of those things, then they would not be eligible to also build an ADU on top of that. But if they are just doing a two-unit development on one lot and they have the room, they would be eligible to also build an ADU.
Okay, thanks again. Yeah, I sort of thought that having an accessory unit in the four-unit placement would be excessive. So
yes.
I thought that's what I was addressing. Okay, thank you very much. You got it for me. Thanks again.
Any other questions from council members? Seeing none, I'm going to take this opportunity to see if there's members of the public that would like to address the council on this item. If so, you may raise your hand in the Zoom application or dial *9. The moderator will give you 3 minutes to speak, or if you prefer, you can write an email to public comment at ci.capitola.ca.us, and the moderator will read your email for up to 3 minutes. Larry, looks like we have one hand up.
Yes, Mayor Story, we have someone dialing in with the from 310 area code.
Thanks. Yes,
hello everyone again. Please bear with me. Public speaking is definitely not my favorite thing. It's my understanding that hypotheticals pretty much never count towards our arena calculation, which is approximately 1,300 units. What I'm really curious about is, I know with SB 10 and SB 35, high-quality bus corridors and train corridors affect how people are actually able to build up even higher and larger. And I was wondering if under SB 9, train corridors also affect that calculation, and if there is something I'm missing there. That's my question.
Before we get to responding to that, I want to see if are there any other members of the public that want to comment on this item?
Mayor Story, I do not see any attendees with their hands raised, and we have not received any emails on this item.
Okay, I'm going to close public comment. I'll bring it back. And I don't know, Ben, if you want to address that question, about whether train corridors affect the SB9.
Yes, the requirements of SB9 apply uniformly to R1 zones, regardless of their proximity to a train corridor. Is the answer to that question.
All right. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to now bring this back to council for further discussion and possible action. Is there a council member that would like to start us off? Council Member Bertrand, you have your hand up. You're on mute right now. We can't hear you.
Okay, I do, and I'm not sure how to phrase the motion, because it's a little complicated, but I do want to make a statement. I was glad there's a mention there in provision for community land trusts, so I'm particularly happy about that, and certainly a good way to make sure affordability is preserved as ownership changes, and so that's sort of a comment. I didn't know if that was part of the law or our staff put that in, but I was glad to read it. So I'll make a motion, Mayor, if you give me some guidance, but I just don't have the text in front of me. So,
if you would like.
I could read this.
Yes, there's the recommended action.
Thank you so much. I will read it at the sufferance of the board and anyone else listening. I move the recommended action, which is the title has been read, no further reading of the ordinance, but it's chapter 16.78 and chapter 17.7, adding municipal code 16.08.02 and amending section 17.74.04 for the implementation of government code sections 66411.7 and 65852.21, which are related to urban lot splits and Senate Bill 9 residential developments. And number two, adopt the proposed resolution authorizing submittal of the coast to the California Coastal Commission for the certification of an amendment to the local coastal program, adding municipal code chapters 16.8 and 17.75, adding municipal code section 16.08020 and amending section 17.74.040 for the implementation of government code sections 66411.7 and 65852.21, which are related to urban lot splits and Senate Bill 9 residential developments. That's my motion.
Thank you. Before we proceed further, is there a second to the motion?
Second.
It was seconded by Councilmember Brown. I would like to propose an amendment to the motion again. And the first amendment would be pertaining to the no off-street parking qualifications and the one pertaining to car share vehicles located within one block. I would like to suggest that we direct the staff to the extent that they're able to provide a definition and clarification of what may constitute a qualifying car share vehicle. So that it's, you know, clear and I think meets our purposes of that exemption. And two, I would like to ask staff to also look at and to the extent that they're able under the statute to provide us with the maximum qualifications for our RENA opportunity site through, you know, the SB9 lot split and development. So those are my proposed amendments to the motion.
Mayor, if I may?
Yes.
I think the definition is well placed. I have a question of staff. It's either Ben or others or Katie. So the idea, you mentioned that we don't usually put arena numbers on our books in this manner. And the example you used, Katie, was the ADUs. That's not a zone that accounts for the arena. So when the state's looking at us. So, you know, I see the intent of what Sam is saying, because we do have to meet arena numbers, as Kristen brought to our attention through ANDAG. We definitely have a big increase. So I want to get a sense, is this something we can do and it actually stands for arena numbers?
Just to clarify, my amendment was to the extent that they could.
Right. Well, I could go along with that, and I see why you said that, but I just want to know if this is a reasonable thing we should even go on.
So in terms of the adopting the ordinance, I I think it would be appropriate to utilize that direction for our housing element when we get into it, to get direction to try to apply SB9 towards our RENA allocation. And we can work with the HCD on that and see if that would be considered. You know, these laws are new, and I'm hopeful that in the future, maybe they'll give a percentage towards single-family housing, since we're, or single-family neighborhoods, since they are requiring more density. But I think, I don't know how we would place that in an ordinance. I think that's more general direction for during the housing element to seek opportunities with ADUs and SB9 development to be included in our RENA. So I can take that as staff and move forward with that recommendation for when we start our housing element. I don't think it would be appropriate to put it in the ordinance at this time. And then adding a definition for car share is definitely something we can place in this ordinance for the second reading.
Okay, thank you, Katie.
I mean, that was my intent concerning the RENA numbers.
Okay.
That it would, that, you know, yes, that you guys would just look at this, and when we are doing a housing element, that's when we have to identify those opportunity sites, whether we can get credit for the SB9 development. That's just my only, that's my point.
But it makes sense when you do the housing element update. It sounds like you do that anyway. So this ordinance doesn't need to direct it at this point, or am I mistaken? I just don't want to have something that we don't need at this point.
To be clear, it will not be included. It's guidance, and it will be implemented during the housing element, is my understanding from the mayor.
Okay.
But the amendment to the ordinance is to add a definition of car share.
Okay. I will accept that guidance. Thank you very much, Sam. And there's a second that needs to.
Yes, Councilmember Brown, are you okay with those amendments?
Yeah, I'll accept.
Okay, thank you. Any further discussion on the motion? Seeing none, Chloe, can we have a roll call vote?
Councilmember Bertrand?
I agree.
Councilmember Brown?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Kaiser?
Aye.
Mayor Story?
Aye. And that motion passes unanimously of the council members who are present. So now we'll move on to the next item, which is 8D. This is objective standards for multifamily and mixed-use residential ordinance. Recommended action is to introduce by title only, waiving further reading of the text and ordinance of the City of Capitola, adding Municipal Code Chapter 17.82 to establish objective standards for multifamily dwelling and mixed-use residential development, amending Section 17.16 Residential Zoning District, Section 17.20 Mixed-Use Zoning District, and 17.24 Commercial and Industrial Zoning Districts to reference Chapter 17.82 Objective Standards for Multifamily Dwelling and Mixed-Use Residential Development, and 2, to adopt the proposed resolution authorizing submittal to the California Coastal Commission for the certification of an amendment to the local coastal plan. Yes, and Katie, you're going to lead us in this one as well?
Yes, actually, I'm going to once again introduce Ben Noble, who's worked hard on this effort. This is, we utilized our SB2 grant funds to draft these objective standards. It'll put us in a much safer place for future multifamily residential and mixed-use projects that come through the City of Capitola. So with that, Ben, take it away.
Look good?
Yes.
Okay, so this is part two for the residential development standards tonight. So the prior item was for SB9 projects and SB9 projects alone. And this item is for multifamily and mixed-use development projects, not anything to do with SB9 projects. So the standards that we're talking about in this ordinance would not apply to an SB9 project. So they're separate things. And for this ordinance that's before the council tonight, it's an amendment to the city zoning code that would establish a new chapter with these objective standards for multifamily and mixed-use residential development. That's the main part of the ordinance. And also included in the zoning code amendments is a simple reference to these new objective standards that live in the zoning district chapters so that readers are less likely to overlook that these standards might apply. And so these standards would apply to new multifamily and mixed-use residential development in all zoning districts that allow these uses except for the MUV. And the reason we excluded the village from this is because as part of the comprehensive zoning code update recently completed, there are adequate objective standards for multifamily mixed-use development that were established as part of an effort to codify previously existing design guidelines. So we felt that there were enough standards in place. We didn't need to tinker with the village standards, and we could just apply these standards to the other zoning districts where these uses are allowed. And the way the ordinance is organized is that we group the standards into five categories related to site planning, building massing, and building detail design of the facade and the roof, sort of addressing the key components of good urban design from a site to a building scale. And for each of those categories of standards, for each of those groups of standards, there's an intent statement. And this intent statement is important because it helps the reader understand what we're aiming to accomplish with these standards, but also because it provides a mechanism for the city to allow for adjustments to standards on a case-by-case basis if needed. So for example, on the screen right here, is an example intent statement for parking and vehicle access, which explains the goal, what we're aiming to accomplish with these standards. So related to parking and vehicle access, one of the standards included in this category is the requirement in most circumstances for parking not to be located between the building and the sidewalk. And the reason for that standard and others within this category is that we want to encourage a pedestrian-friendly streetscape, walkable neighborhood. We don't want parking facilities to dominate the street frontage, and we really want to encourage residents to walk, bike, and take transit to destinations. So that's an example of an intent statement that's in the ordinance. And as I mentioned previously, an applicant may request a deviation from one or more standards through the design permit process. And that's a request that would go to the Planning Commission, who would be able to approve the deviation upon finding that the project incorporates an alternative method to achieve the intent statement. So if an applicant is requesting a deviation, that project would not be eligible for streamlined ministerial approval under SB 35. And so SB 35 is the state law that allows for an applicant proposing a project with a certain percentage of affordable housing and that also meets other eligibility requirements to obtain streamlined ministerial approval without a public hearing. So if an applicant is requesting a deviation from one or more standards, that project would not be eligible for project for ministerial approval under SB 35. So here's a way of an example of this concept of deviating from standards. Within the objective standards, there's a section on building massing. And the intent of these standards, to a large extent, is to break up larger buildings into smaller volumes so that they appear more compatible with Capitola's existing context. So we want to avoid monolithic blocks that are out of scale and out of character to the surrounding context. So to address that issue, we've included standards for massing breaks. So if you're a smaller building, you're subject to a relatively modest inset within the front building wall to create a little more visual interest. If you're a much larger building, there's a requirement for a larger inset to break up the massing of the building so that it might read more as a series of connected volumes rather than one single monolithic volume. And so this is a standard that we think generally would work well for a project of this scale, but there is the possibility that a project could come forward where there might be a better method to achieve the intent of the massing standard, and we really want to provide a pathway for an applicant to propose this alternative method and to let the Planning Commission determine through the design permit process if that alternative method is actually preferable to the standard, because there may be some cases where that's the case. And so we want to maintain that flexibility, but the city still has that protection where if a project is requesting ministerial approval through SB 35, that there is a massing break standard in place to ensure that the city is not required to approve a monolithic block that would be really out of scale and out of character to capitalist context. So this is just to provide a bit of an example of why we've included this ability to deviate from standards and how it might be utilized. Okay, so two more slides left. So this is a project under CEQA as an amendment to your zoning code, but staff's recommendation is that the common sense CEQA exemption would apply to this zoning code amendment because there's no possibility the project would cause a significant environmental impact. What this project really is doing is codifying through objective standards existing subjective requirements that are included in the design permit criteria as a way to protect the city in cases of development projects coming forward that are requesting streamlined ministerial approval. And all non-ministerial projects that come forward that are subject to these design standards would also be subject to the city's CEQA review as part of that development application review. So with that, staff's recommendation is to introduce and waive further reading of the zoning code amendments with these new objective standards, and that would be consistent with the Planning Commission recommendation when this ordinance was before them, and then also to adopt the resolution authorizing staff to submit these amendments to the Coastal Commission to certify the LCP. So that concludes my presentation, and we're happy to answer any questions.
Yeah. Thank you once again, Ben. And are there questions from council on the staff presentation? Seeing none, I'm going to now ask if there's members of the public that would like to address the council on this item. If so, you can raise your hand in Zoom or dial *9. The moderator will allow you to speak, and you'll have up to 3 minutes. If you prefer, you can also send an email to public comment at ci.capitola.ca.us. And then I see that we have one hand up.
Yes, Mayor Starr, we have a person with the 310 area code.
Hey, folks, it's me again. So streamlined ministerial approval essentially means no public input and waiving CEQA. I'm following correctly. And as far as SB 35 goes, SB 35 is deeply affected by train corridors. It allows mixed-use residential and commercial buildings, I thought, too. And I was wondering if what you guys are talking about right now applies to these larger buildings that people are going to be able to get approved, and if they can override our local planning commission if we don't approve them. I also think that what you guys are putting in here, I know a little bit about this stuff. I've written some policy, and these are very wise protections for the town to incorporate into its codes. So thank you again, and I feel I'm getting better at this, so yeah.
Hey, are there any other members of the public that would like to address the council on this item?
Mayor Story, I do not see any other attendees wishing to speak, and I do not have any emails on this item.
Dan, at your discretion, I was wondering if you wanted to address the question about SB 35 and, again, train corridors.
Right. So I guess the answer to that would be that these new objective standards apply in all areas where multifamily and mixed-use residential development is allowed outside of the village. We have tried to draft these standards in a way that would be accommodate a range of intensities so that these standards would work for lower intensity multifamily projects as well as higher intensity multifamily projects and mixed use projects that might be more appropriate around a transit hub or a transit train corridor area.
Yeah, thank you for that. So with that, I'm going to bring this now back to council for further deliberation and possible action. The council member that would like to address the agenda item.
Again, I'll make the motion that I need. Yes, thank you very much, Mayor. May I have the floor?
Don't thank me. I didn't do that. Thank you.
Okay. Maybe Larry or someone. Thank you, or Kate. Thank you. I move the recommended action, number one, introduced by title only, waiving further reading of the text, an ordinance of the City of Capitola adding Municipal Code Chapter 17.82 to establish objective standards for multifamily dwellings and mixed-use residential development, amending Section 17.16, Residential Zoning Districts, Section 17.20, Mixed-Use Zoning Districts, and 17.24, Commercial and Industrial Zoning Districts, to reference Chapter 17.82, Objective Standards for Multifamily Dwellings and Mixed-Use Residential Development, and 2, adopt a proposed resolution authorizing submittal to the California Coastal Commission for the certification of an amendment to the local coastal plan program. Excuse me.
The motion by Councilmember Bertrand, is there a second?
You can second that.
Seconded by Vice Mayor Kaiser. So we have a motion. And before I call for a roll call vote, I just want to thank Katie and Ben and the other staff who worked on this to assure that we are in compliance with state laws, but at the same time, preserving the quality of our neighborhoods and really the look and feel of Capitola. I think you have a sense of, you know, we're trying to accomplish both of those goals at the same time, and I know it's a difficult task. So thank you, and with that, I'll ask for a roll call vote.
Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Brown.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Kaiser.
Aye.
Mayor Story.
an aye. And the motion passes unanimously of those council members who are present. And that now brings us to item B. Yes.
Sorry, Sam.
Sorry.
I always seem to have questions. This is a question for Katie. So passing these two ordinances, well, multiple ordinances, does this set us up better for doing the housing element? It seems to me, you know, we're not going to have conflicts because we're totally in line with California.
Yeah, I think it, at this point we're up to date on, you know, the new state legislation. It really puts us in a better time to put a lot of staff or resources towards the housing element. It definitely positions us much better in terms of working on and focusing in on the housing element. So, yeah.
Okay, that's what I thought, and you sort of made some comments to that effect in a sense, so I just wanted to address that. Thank you very much, Mayor, for giving me that option to have one last question.
You're welcome. Well, with that, I am now going to adjourn this meeting until our next special meeting, which is going to be held on May the 19th, 2022, starting at 6 p.m., at this location, and then our next regularly scheduled meeting will be on May 26th at 2022, starting at 7 p.m. So once again, thank you to staff for helping us to keep the city you know, running in a wonderful place. Thank you, Ben, for your assistance in this matter. And as always, be kind to yourself and be kind to others. Thank you. Good night, everyone. Good night, Capitola.